10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Welcome.
Do or do not. There is no try.
You called down the thunder, well, now you've got it.
It's time.
Hey guys, hey, this is Kelly Powers with the Berean Perspective. Thank you for joining this special stream today. I'm going to be in just a few moments doing a little bit of a review pertaining to a debate that took place between a guy named Dan Chapa and a guy named Turton Fan with Sam Shamoun and William Albrecht not too long ago on a channel called Standing for Truth Channel. And the purpose of my video today is to give a response briefly, we'll see how that goes, in relationship to the Assumption of Mary doctrine as a dogma pertaining to one of the dogmas that is essential for salvation, and namely, is this doctrine, the Assumption of Mary, really taught according to the scriptures? I say completely and unequivocally no. But we'll get to that in just a little bit. If you're new to my channel, please subscribe. Please like this video and leave a comment at the end of it, please. And then if you'd like to help support this ministry in any way, I have two options. You can do it through PayPal, and there's also a link, also what's called Give, Send, Go. If you'd like to help support this ministry in any way through monthly or one-time contribution, thank you so much. Appreciate that. Lord bless you. Well, let's get into it right here. Let's put it up on the big screen for you guys to see. This took place not too long ago. Let's just see. When was that? 5 days ago or so. And this was on the debate with whether or not the Assumption of Mary is basically biblical. Now, my particular perspective is that it is not biblical. And when you're looking at the scriptures, you're looking at what was taught pertaining to Mary. Let me just give you a quick overview here of what we see after the birth of Jesus is what I'm going to be talking about. After the birth of Jesus, not when Mary was considered pregnant and the supernatural birth, but like what was taught by Jesus and the apostles pertaining to Mary after he was born into this world. Now, we know, obviously, when he was born, when he was also 12 years of age, his parents apparently lost him for a few days, wasn't really sure what was going on with him, and said, why have you done this to us? And Jesus says, well, wouldn't you know that'd be about my father's business? So it's a little bit peculiar on that one as well, but I don't have that on the screen right now, but that's one that just popped in my head right now. But he was a child at the age of 12. But this is the teachings of Jesus now. So this is in Matthew 12, and here's what it says here on the screen. As you can see, Matthew 12 here. While he was still speaking to the crowds, behold, his mother and brothers were standing outside seeking to speak to him. Someone said to him, behold, your mother and your brothers are standing outside seeking to speak to you. But Jesus answered the one who was telling him and said, who is my mother and who are my brothers? Now, the reason why I point that out is because sometimes what will happen is Catholics will try to use this to state, well, see, this is just talking about spiritual brothers, not literal brothers, right? Well, if that's the case, then obviously then too, Jesus would have been saying his mom, Mary, isn't really his biological, if you will, who wanted to brought him into this world through the incarnation. She's just my spiritual mother. Now, Jesus was using this as an illustration saying, hey, who truly are my brothers and sisters? Who are the people, true people of faith? Stretching out his hand toward the disciples, he said, behold, my mother and my brothers. Whoever does the will of my Father who is in heaven, he is my brother, sister, and mother. Now, this is what pertaining to the doctrine of Mariology, this is interesting because we also know that here we see how Jesus is talking to the crowds and he speaks about his mother. We see something else as well over here in Matthew 13. When he had finished these parables, he departed from there and he came to his own hometown, began teaching them in their synagogue. so that they were astonished and said, where did this man get these miraculous powers, right? Where did he get these things, right? And we see that he is speaking to the crowds. And what is being stated here? They were astonished. And so it says, is this not the carpenter's son? Is not his mother called Mary and his brothers, James, Joseph, Simon, and Judas? Are not his sisters? Are they not all with us? So here we see something pertaining to his family, biological brothers, biological sisters, Adelphi and Adelpho. And we see here in regards to this here that we see no place anywhere in Scripture where we'd see cousins ever be used other than cousins. And it's clear from just simple Bible reading here, this is talking about Jesus having biological brothers. We see this again, just to point this out, pertaining to his mothers and brothers. In Mark chapter 6, once again, is this not the carpenter, the son of Mary, the brother of James, Joseph, Judas, and Simon? Are not his sisters here with us? And they took offense to him. These are two places that clearly talk about that. Now, another place I'd like to highlight here is in John chapter 2, where John over here, he says something interesting, or Jesus says something interesting in John chapter 2. Notice here in John chapter 2, something very interesting here. This is John chapter 2. On the third day, there was a wedding in the Cana of Galilee. Mother of Jesus was there. Both Jesus and disciples were invited to the wedding. When the wine ran out, the mother of Jesus ran to him. They have no wine. Jesus said to her, woman, what does it have to do with us? My hour is yet not come. Now, this is not a sign of disrespect. Woman is a sign of respect. But notice he doesn't say mother, doesn't say, you know, anything like that. There's no Marian doctrines here. Nothing. But again, the point, though, is this is a specific time when Jesus is talking pertaining to Mary. His mother said to the servants, whatever he says to you, do it. Now, this is just a sign because she was in charge at this time involved with the wedding. So she is being Jesus' mother by biological, right, through the incarnation. We get this, right? We see that significance. But here again, we don't see anything special pertaining to Marian doctrines. I know that's going to offend people, but it's still true. Later on in the Gospel of John, towards the end of Jesus' physical ministry, being a man who through his incarnation, though he was God come in the flesh, we know this, but taking on humanity before the cross and the resurrection, he is getting ready to be put on the, you know, he's getting ready to be his last moments, he's going to be crucified here. And therefore, it says here, therefore the soldiers did these things, but standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother, his mother's sister, and Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. Now, why this is interesting, because we see Jesus' mother being there, which would be Mary, right? When Jesus saw his mother and his disciple whom he loved, you know this being talked about, John the Apostle, he said to his mother, woman, behold your son. So speaking about John. Then he said to the disciples, behold your mother. From that hour, the disciple took her into his own household. Now, some people will say, well, why didn't he point to his actual other brothers or sisters, right? Now, it's possible also during this time, we don't have it written down, but we have nothing mentioned of Joseph after pretty much Matthew 13 and Mark 6. So we're not really sure. Church history gives things that he did pass, but nothing's recorded here, right? So why did Jesus point to John, but not his other brothers, if the accusation against Protestants is, well, why didn't, you know, if he's got biological brothers, why didn't he point to them? Well, at this time, his other brothers were not believers. We can read about that in John 7. We see that his actual other brothers did not actually truly believe him until after the resurrection. So he puts Mary, his mother, in the custody, if you will, not custody, but basically under John's supervision, right? And John, being one of those who was close to Jesus, he says to him also as well. He said to the disciple, verse 27, behold your mother. From that hour, the disciple took her into his own household. So we get that. But again, point being is, where is the special teaching from Jesus about Marian doctrines or Mariology? After Jesus has been resurrected, after Jesus has been resurrected from the dead, appears to disciples, and then now the disciples are waiting to know what's going to be taking place. This is during Pentecost. Here in Acts chapter 1, we see what's going on there in the upper room. They were getting ready to pray. We see the list of the different disciples there. These all were with one mind, were continually devoting themselves to prayer, along with the other women, and the Mary, the mother of Jesus, and his brothers. Notice here again, Mary, the mother of Jesus, and his brothers, right? So here we see Mary once again being mentioned. After Acts 1:14, we do not see Mary being mentioned in the book of Acts, nor do we see Mary being taught about in the apostles' teachings in the epistles. The one place we would get to would be Galatians 4, talking about Jesus being born of a woman in reference to his incarnation. But nothing other than this throughout the rest of the New Testament ever addresses Mariology, Marian doctrines. Well, why is that important? Because in this debate with these guys, Dan Chapa in the middle there, Church and Fan, you can see to the bottom left, and then you've got William Albrecht and Sam Shamounian on the top right and bottom right, right? Here is the debate that's going to be taking place with these guys. And what's interesting here is this is the question that you're going to see that's first asked by me. That basically says here, and my question to them was, neither Jesus, apostles, apostolic church fathers, this is the early apostolic church fathers, this is like 300, before 325 AD. So before this, this is pre-Nicaea. These are the apostolic church fathers within the first, second, third century. This is the time frame we're looking at. They did not teach the assumption of Mary. So why is this Roman Catholic Church dogma, I forgot to put the M there, dogma, salvific, but yet it's not biblical? And then later on, I asked a second question, similar, and they laughed and chuckled. If this assumption of Mary is essential for faith, i.e. salvation, why did it take place? Why did the RC take to 1950 to make this a dogma to be saved? Let me show this on the screen for you guys here real quick. Actually, that's the wrong one here. On the screen here, this is from official teaching of the Catholic Church. And I'll put it on the screen, you guys can see it better there. It's from Vatican.va. And this is talking about when in 1950, the dogmas were being essentially for salvation pertaining to Mary. And two of them are explicit here, talking about the Immaculate Conception, i.e. Mary being born without sin, which is not biblical as well. But pertaining to this debate, the Assumption of Mary. Look at number six here. Here we see it. Thus, when it was solemnly proclaimed that Mary, the Virgin, Mother of God, was from the beginning free from the taint of original sin, obviously talking about Immaculate Conception, the mind of the faithful were filled with a stronger hope that the day might soon come when the dogma of the Virgin Mary's bodily assumption into heaven would also be defined by the church's supreme teaching authority, i.e. the magisterium. Now look at 47. Here's the crux of this issue. One of the main reasons why I'm against Marian doctrines, Mariology. If the perpetual virginity was biblical, I wouldn't have a problem with that. It doesn't take away from anything from me as being a Protestant. But the Immaculate Conception and the Assumption of Mary are both considered dogmas essential for salvation, and the issue of her being a mediatrix, I would also believe completely unbiblical, her being a mediator, the veneration of Mary, that kind of stuff, right? So here we see number 47 says, it is forbidden to any man to change this or our declaration, pronouncement, definition, or by rash attempt to expose or counter it. If any man should presume to make such an attempt, let him know that he will incur the wrath of Almighty God and of the blessed apostles, Peter and Paul. So why is this significant? Well, this is significant for a few reasons. Is because this is a salvific issue according to those of the Catholic Church, according to those who are defenders of the church, such as people like William Albrecht and others who have openly declared that this is a salvation issue, which I will be playing a full discussion from my discussion with William Albrecht that had my debates on my channel. The link's also here. But I'll be playing where I went to my cross-examination asking explicitly on this question and pressing him on why is this doctrine so important, the Marian doctrines, specifically Marian doctrines, salvific when they're not actually taught by Jesus or the apostles. So let me give you a couple of quick things before we get into these videos. Watch this over here as well. This is important here too. So when I put this on the screen, I want you guys to see this here as well, fully. This is from the Catechism of the Catholic Church. And notice here a few things in regards to Church's authority and Pope. Notice here towards the bottom there, 95, it is clear, therefore, that in the supremely wise arrangement of God, sacred tradition, sacred scripture, and the magisterium of the church are so connected and associated that one of them cannot stand without the others. So they all three have to work together. Working together in its own way under the action of one Holy Spirit, they all contribute effectively to the salvation of souls. So this is something that people have to adhere to in order to follow. Look at number 100. The task of interpreting the Word of God authentically, say that fast, has been entrusted solely to the magisterium of the church. That is, to the Pope and the bishops in communion with him. So in other words, to interpret the Word of God has been entrusted solely to the magisterium. So in other words, even people like William Albrecht, Sam, even though Sam is not Catholic or Orthodox, he's playing the fence on both sides. He's playing the buffet. That's why I call him Sammy Buffet. He picks and chooses what he wants to go along with what he believes, right? But William adheres to the magisterium, and people are Roman Catholic. They have to adhere to what the magisterium teaches. Even in a debate not too long ago with Robert Sungenis, who was debating Steve Christie, Sungenis openly admitted that, yeah, you know what? These types of doctrines, of Marian doctrines, they weren't taught clearly early on. They weren't taught as a salvific. But he has to adhere to what the magisterium teaches because he is Roman Catholic. We see here up here in the top 882, the Pope, Bishop of Rome, Peter's successor for the Catholic Church, is the perpetual invisible source and foundation of the unity both of the bishops and the whole community of the faithful. For the Roman pontiff, by reason of his office as vicar of Christ and as pastor of the entire church, has full, supreme, universal power over the whole church, a power which he can always exercise unhindered. That is completely not taught by Jesus, not taught by Peter himself, not taught by Paul. This was not taught at all by the New Testament and was not taught, even though Catholics will claim it was, not taught by the early apostolic fathers. There was no type of authority like this being taught early on. This came much later. 891 states, the Roman pontiff, head of the College of Bishops, enjoys this infallibility in virtue of this of his office, when as supreme pastor and teacher of all the faithful who confirms his brethren in the faith, he proclaims a definitive act of doctrine pertaining to faith or morals. The infallibility promised to the church is also present in the body of bishops when together with the Peter's successor, they exercise the supreme magisterium, above all in the ecumenical council. This infallibility extends as far as the deposit of divine revelation itself. So this goes back to, again, once again, to looking at what 195 teaches, that essentially no one can interpret the Bible properly or have any kind of authority without the magisterium and the traditions from the Catholic Church. All right, so let's put this back on the screen here for us to look at. We're going to walk through this video, but I also want to put up briefly here too that, just to be very clear, this is from Catholic Rebuttal.com. And this is a question was, is which of the early, which church fathers the first five centuries taught and believed in the assumption of Mary, right? So this is the first five centuries. The first three centuries, first, second, third century, this was not taught. The assumption of Mary was not taught. You'll actually see that it comes here from Epiphanius. Here it talks about here, first being kind of really written about 350 AD. So that's way later. That's after the Nicene. That's after the apostolic early church fathers. This is 350 AD, right? Now, that's what's being stated here. Talks about like the bodies of saints, however, she has been held in honor of her character understanding. If I should say anything more in her praise, she is like Elijah, who was virgin from her mother's womb, always remained so, and was taken up, but not seen death, right? There's even controversy in the Catholic Church. Did she actually see death or not? But I'm not going to bring that up right now. So there's one. We also see what's going on here, but this is all that's basically stated. From early on, we see there, however, the early, why here, look at this here. This is interesting. However, why didn't the early church fathers address the assumption? Staples notes that the teaching wasn't an issue for them because the doctrine wasn't being attacked. Indeed, it didn't need to be defended. Well, I thought that's interesting. So let's look at what Staples had to say over here. So here we see the Staples, again, Catholic.com. And he's talking about here about the assumption of Mary. I'm talking about the biblical evidence. There's no biblical evidence for it. So I'm going to peruse through a lot of this here because there's basically not much going on here. I want to get to the crux of what he is really getting at here, right? So we're going to get down, just kind of scrolling down here. I want to get to it. So here's where we get to, going back to what was being said a moment ago. Why don't the earliest fathers write about the assumption of Mary? The most obvious reason would be that when Gnostics, who were some of the main enemies of the faith, were in early centuries of the Christian era, agreed with the church on the matter, there would have been no need to defend the teaching. In other words, there is no record of anyone disagreeing on the matter. We don't find works from the earliest fathers on Jesus of Selvis either. Watch, this is kind of silly. But that too was most likely due to the universal agreement on that topic. Much of the early literature was apologetic in nature. Like the New Testament, it mostly dealt with the problem areas of the church that needed to be addressed. So we can read from scripture about Jesus obviously being celibate because he's never married. He never had a family. Therefore, we can clearly see that being taught in scripture that there's no need for it. So the issue here is well, if this is a dogma, because we can go through the New Testament of what the gospel is, what a person must believe to be saved. There can be much debate on that. Whether faith alone, faith plus works. The issue of, do you need to be water baptized? These are different things that can be, at least in the scriptures, to be debated. You got to believe in just Jesus Christ simply alone. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you shall be saved. Acts 16:31. You know, John 3:16, Romans 10:9-13, Ephesians 2:8-9. You can go down the list of scriptures that talk about this, right? But where do we see anything about Mary? It's silent. And what's interesting here, too, is even Staples, who is supposed to be this great apologist for the Catholic Church, doesn't give anything directly. There's no substance to what he gives in this argument for the assumption of Mary, and i.e. especially why it would have to be dogmatic and essential for salvation. So notice the final thoughts here. It says here, since the time of, I don't know how to properly, the promulgation of the dogma of the assumption of Mary, there has been much new discovery. Obviously, 1950, you have a lot of time to add a whole lot of traditions that just simply are not at all remotely taught by Jesus or the apostles or the apostolic fathers. Now we have written evidence of belief in the Assumption of Mary as far back as the third century. Yeah, okay, that's great. Back 350 AD. Good job. Though it is not necessary for there to be written evidence at all way back to the second century for us as Catholics, because we have sacred tradition. So here it is. We have sacred tradition and sacred scripture as interpreted by who? The magisterium of the church, first and foremost, that has already given us the truth of this matter. Let me just highlight this here. Really, really important here. This is key to this issue. Staples openly says something shocking. Though it is not necessary for there to be written evidence all the way back to the second century for us as Catholics, because we have sacred tradition and sacred scripture, even though there's nothing in sacred scripture on this at all, as interpreted by the magisterium of the church. Why is that interesting? Because remember, the magisterium is the only ones who can truly tell you how to understand the Bible. Isn't that crazy? So let's get into this discussion. So here's where we're going to get into my first question being asked. And notice right away them laughing, being silly, because in my debates that I've had with William, where I was on his channel. It was also recorded on my channel as well. I asked him point blank, and I'm going to play this in a little bit and let you see it for yourselves if you haven't seen already, and you'll see how he dropped the ball, how he fumbled, how he could not in any way prove these essentials for salvation. Then also in my debate a little while back when Sam was doing the Jerry Springer show, brought me on his channel, kept removing me and muting me and doing all that, doing his control freak stuff. Over there, if you remember correctly, he was trying to control me. But over there, he could not prove he had any authority from what sources. He couldn't prove why venerated Mary, and he couldn't prove why pray to Mary. He failed on all three accounts. So I've dealt with both these guys, and even though they will laugh, they'll mock, they'll make jokes, both of these guys failed to prove what they believe from the Bible. Did they try to give answers? Sure. But they both failed. They provided eisegesis, not exegesis. So let's get into this video. Let's get it going. Here we go.
Okay, here we go. So let me see here. First question. Okay, first question comes in from Berean Perspective Apologetics. I know you all have a little bit of history. So here we go.
So listen to the question. I've already given you the question already. And listen to how they respond, and then I'll give a follow-up response to their response. Listen carefully.
Okay, $7 super chat. Appreciate the support. Question for Sam and William. And I will say to the audience, some questions have come in that I find are not professional enough or respectful enough to our guests tonight. That includes all four guests. Yeah. We're not gonna ask those ones. We're gonna make sure we're sticking to questions that are on topic and on point. Okay, so with that disclaimer, here we go. Yeah. So his question is, neither Jesus, apostles, apostolic church fathers taught the Assumption of Mary. Why is the RCC
dogma, salvific,
but not biblical? Gentlemen, go ahead.
No, you have to explain the dogma part, then I can follow up. So what do you want to say about that?
To be very clear about it, I think we made it. By the way, Donnie, do we have a limited, like a minute or 2 minutes? What is?
Yeah, why don't we do 2 minutes each? So basically, okay. You and Sam get 2 minutes.
Okay, let me, I don't want to go way over. So, okay. To be very clear, we made the very clear argument tonight that this is biblically based, very clearly taught by St. John. But another thing that we don't do that my friend Kelly has the bad habit of doing is pitting the Bible against itself. He did that very clearly. Go look at our debate on the perpetual virginity. He did that very clearly there where he'll say, well, look, I don't care if one Bible book does teach it. Well, where did Christ talk about it? We believe the whole Bible is the inerrant.
I never said that. I never said it. I don't care what if one Bible book taught it. I asked, just give one reference from Jesus. Where did Jesus teach these Marian doctrines or dogmas? Where did the apostles teach it? And he failed on both. And he also failed on the early apostolic fathers teaching this was essential for salvation. So he actually struck out 1, 2, and 3.
Errant word of God. And if we find it only in one book, that is sufficient. Even if it's found in only one book, that would be sufficient. So be very clear about that. We made a very clear biblical case tonight. We built from that biblical case with the early church fathers. As far as the apostolic early church fathers, of course, they don't talk about it. There's a lot of things that they don't talk about.
Now, what's interesting too is he just openly said that they didn't talk about the apostolic. This is the early apostolic fathers, the first few centuries. This is a salvific issue. Salvation. And they didn't talk about it. There's a problem here.
But to be clear about one other thing, Kelly, I don't think if the apostolic fathers taught this that you would believe it, because the apostolic fathers taught a lot of things. The Holy Eucharist truly is the body and blood of Christ. And I can bring up tons of things that you don't believe in. So I don't think your standard are the apostolic fathers, just to be very clear about it. And then you say,
that's just a deflection. Yeah. Okay. They did talk about things with the Eucharist and water baptism. That's fine. That's a different discussion. What about Mary? Why is the Marian doctrines silent from the first few centuries? And not only that, zero having to do with the gospel for salvation to be saved. This is key. This is important. You can debate whether the Eucharist is essential for salvation. You can debate whether water baptism. Why? Because there are scriptures that will point to that, that you can debate that topic. Not saying I agree with what the topic conclusion is, that they are essential for salvation, but at least those things are actually somewhere in scripture that can be debated. There is nothing in the Bible, nor in the early church fathers, that give apostolic fathers talking about this issue. That's where, again, William fails.
Hey, why is the Roman Catholic dogma salvific? Okay, I think I've already answered that. So I think that it is biblical, and anything that is biblical is very important to follow. So hopefully I answered that. I went a minute and a half. I didn't go 2 minutes. Sam, do you want?
So he didn't answer it. He didn't answer why the question that is being asked here, why is it salvific? He thinks it's biblical. Anything biblical is important. I would agree with that. Anything biblical, yeah. You know, there's the story of Noah. Very important. Creation, very important. Yes. What if you're an old earther and you don't necessarily believe in young earth? Is that a salvation issue? No. But that's still important to know the right from wrong. I believe in the young earth. I believe old earth is wrong. But it's not salvific. What about the issue of what day you may worship on? Sunday or Saturday? That's important. I believe the Sabbath is still Saturday, but we as Christians can worship both on Saturday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. Guess what? Friday too, right? But in the New Testament, what day we worship on is not salvific. So the issue here comes back to the problem. Houston, we have a problem. William did not answer the question of why is this dogma salvific for someone to believe in. Let's see if Sam can do better.
I want to piggyback on that.
Yeah. So we have 30 seconds, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, real quickly, like you said, even if it was demonstrating scripture, he would still explain it away. For example, he mentioned apostolic fathers. Ignatius affirms a monarchical episcopate, that you had a mono-episcopacy, where you had the bishop, presbyters, elders. Now, Ignatius is a disciple of the apostles appointed by them, and he was the bishop, and he died as a martyr. Now, will he now repent and accept that structure? Okay, so it comes from a father who knew the apostles who appointed him? No, he's going to explain it away.
So right there, he's assuming something, and William's shaking his head as if he's agreeing with it. Sam's an idiot. Okay, he has no idea what church structure authority is. He has no authority for himself. I have been in churches before as an elder, as a pastor, as a lay pastor, doing different things, youth, children's ministries, different things, whatever, outreach. I've actually been mentored under pastors and put in different church ministry positions. Yes, the early church actually had presbyters, actually had elders. They had structure. But Sammy Buffet, there was no popes. There was no one person over the whole church. This came much later. So for you to just attack me to say, oh, well, Kelly agree with that? Of course, Kelly agrees with that. That's a biblical model. We have church structure, church leadership. If you actually had a clue what church ministry was, you would know that. But you falsely accuse me of that. So wrong answer. All right, let's see if it gets any better.
So this is nothing but smoke and mirrors, to not to deal with what the scripture does say and how the fathers interpreted the data.
Okay, I appreciate it.
So that was their answers, guys. That was their answers to this important, relevant question. You know what they get for that?
Wrong answer!
All right, so we're going to move on. We're going to let now Turret and Fan and also Dan Chapa answer. And then, of course, they get a final response as well. But let's see how they respond. I was hoping that they would get it. And they did. They did actually pretty decent. But let's let them answer for themselves.
Gentlemen, Team Dan and Turretin, floor is yours. Go ahead. Oh, Dan, I think you might be on mute if you are talking.
Yeah, you're on mute, my friend.
Oh, thanks.
I'm going to mute myself now.
Appreciate it. Okay, so the Revelation 12 text, for starters, I agree with the premise behind the question. If it's not clearly taught in scriptures, then it's not necessary for salvation, because the Christ revealed what we need to believe to be saved to the apostles, and they taught it, and they wrote it down in scripture. And that is the very purpose that's given, especially in the Gospel of John and 1 John, for their writings. So to add to that is a highly problematic. And as far as it being clearly taught in Revelation 12, again, what we have is Mary. She shows up in Bethlehem for the birth, and she's back into heaven, and then she shows up in the desert, and then she's back up in heaven. Like, so where is she? Also, when is she? Because those are historical events, but this is supposedly happened after her life. Face. And then who is she? Is she Eve?
I love that face.
She Mary? Is she Israel? Is she
shaking
the church?
His head.
It's about as far from clear as I can get. So I throw my hands up at that point.
I agree with Dan. Good job.
Thank you, Dan. Turretin, anything you want to add?
Sure, I'll just briefly add, the accusation of smoke and mirrors is frankly unwarranted, because the contention is about whether or not something is a historical fact. And the absence of the centuries of silence on this is important to a historical inquiry. Even if you think we would disregard what, you know, Ignatius says as an apostolic father, That's really aside from the point. The reason we would reject what Ignatius says is whether or not he has support of scripture. Not now, whether some historical event happened, we do a historical investigation. It's not the same thing. But anyway, we already used up a lot of our time.
Okay.
So real quickly here. So Turnman did a decent job there, because whether Ignatius said something or not, it was still collaborating with scripture. And if you noticed, Sam, you saw him shaking his head, because why? Because when he's in a formal debate, he can't just cut someone off or bounce them out of his room, right? So he actually has to listen. It's kind of comical. But they have a follow-up here. Let's see if they get another crack at this one. Let's see if they get any better.
Thank you, Turretin. William and Sam, you guys
Sam,
get the last
I'll
word.
I'll let Sam respond to that. We get the last word.
Two things. Number one, notice how he begs the question. He goes, even if Ignatius taught it, it doesn't matter if it's not supported scripture. But the problem is that the scriptures that he's now using to bash these fathers were actually the scriptures that came through these very bishops appointed by the apostles and preserved by them. So if they couldn't understand that the New Testament rejects the monoepiscopacy, that means these guys were a bunch of misfits. So he ends up becoming a restorationist. So he should become a Mormon, because the church became apostate. And secondly, Dan,
That's completely just a bunch of garbage. First off, he wasn't bashing the church fathers. That's just a stupid accusation. Number two, the issue of biblical account of canon or books for that matter, not only do we have the Old Testament already in place prior to any organization of the Catholic Church later in the 4th and 5th century, right? But what we also had early on from the 1st and 2nd century, almost majority of the New Testament, literally majority of the New Testament, was already recognized by the early church fathers. In fact, if you look at just the first few centuries, you have almost over 36,000 plus quotes and references from the New Testament. The New Testament, all but five or so verses, gives us the whole New Testament. What was their credentials for teaching and doctrine, the early church fathers? What did they go to? They went to scripture. Did the church fathers use the words sola scriptura? No. But what was their authority? Scripture. So sola scriptura was that. That's all that Turgeon Fan is talking about here. We go to scripture. That was my whole question as well, is that if this is not taught by Peter or the apostles, or for that matter, even the early apostolic fathers, then why would you even hint at believe in this? And it makes me just shake my head with laughter that these guys are trying to defend this when there's literally nothing there that they can attempt to defend this false doctrine with, other than accusations, jabs here and there at these nice guys, and just basically misrepresentation that what Sam does all the time.
Love, I say, go watch the debate. You've grossly misrepresented what we said. You did not represent what I said. I didn't say that the woman becomes Israel or Eve or Mary when it's convenient. If you are being honest, and I know you're honest because you fear Jesus and you believe he's the God of truth, you will see that I said it's Eve, woman, and Mary, because the typology is there that shows it's referring to Eve, Israel, and Mary. And then if you had heard what I said that the reason why she's already to heaven is because this shows that she's destined to reign in heaven with her son. So please stop misrepresenting my arguments. I try not to do that with you. The reason why she's in heaven, though these events aren't, because that's showing you that God has destined her, like he destined her child, to reign in heaven. Just like the child was born on earth, then he went to heaven to reign. Same with the figure. That's only confirming her ultimate destiny. So represent my arguments accurately, my brother. Please.
All right. So a lot of false accusations here because they did not misrepresent Sam. He just irritated, as always. He needs some happy pills. He needs to go, you know, smile somewhere. Basically, there's a lot of accusations there, wasting time. And again, here's the thing. The question once again was asked. Neither Jesus, the apostles, apostolic fathers taught the Assumption of Mary, which is true. They didn't prove it. They didn't prove it. Jesus never taught it. The apostles never taught it. Book of Revelation chapter 12 does not teach that. The apostolic fathers did not teach it. And yet, it's a dogma in the Catholic Church as essential for salvation. And if anyone rejects it, they're going to incur the wrath of God. So that's really important. All right, we're going to move on then to my second question that gets asked over here. I'm just going to fast forward right over here. I think it's just coming up after this one here.
Okay, we're good to go.
All right, so here's the next one.
Okay, here we go. Next.
So you're going to see right away them smile and laugh again, and rightly so. But now I'm even asking once again, so if the Assumption of Mary is essential for the faith for salvation, now, okay, so if you're saying, you know, it's important, it's relevant, you know, even if I don't agree it's Bible, but if you like at least trying to say it's something there, okay, I get that. But this was not considered earlier on as salvific for salvation. So before 1950, so let's say 1949, if you didn't necessarily believe in this Assumption of Mary, it wasn't a salvation. But now it is. This is something within the last, you know, 1950. So you got what? 73 years ago, right? So that's not that long ago. This is a salvation issue. And as I read earlier, remember what I read earlier? This is what I read. Let me put it back up on the screen here for you guys to see. Just put it up there. Remember 47? It is forbidden to any man to change this, our declaration, pronouncement, and definition, or by rash attempt to oppose, counter it. If any man should presume to make such an attempt, let him know that he will incur the wrath of the Almighty God, right? So this is a salvation issue. And now watch how these guys laugh and mock once again. And notice, again, they have a second shot at this once again. And yet they, again, fumble all over the place and do not answer this question properly. Watch.
Next one. So we're down to our last three.
Watch their faces.
The last three are for Sam and William.
I love it. So it's basically the same question, but repackaged by
Berean. Yeah, it's all right.
It does look very.
But this is more specific to why did it take to 1950? Pay attention to why did it take to the RCC to 1950? That's the question. Let's see if they actually answer it.
Very similar to the previous
okay,
one.
Okay, hey, as so long as he's giving you money, hey.
Go for it.
Yeah, let's
take your last three super chats. You can do
guys on the spot. I said my part. Expose their false teachers.
Right. Same question we package, but go ahead.
Here we go. So, Kelly Power. Clear,
this is why I did these two questions, just so you guys understand this as well. These two questions I did. Not only do I want to help support Donnie, of course, he's a fellow Christian brother in the faith. But these two questions, I knew that they would have to answer. And I wanted it to be very clear, because if they were able to demonstrate from Jesus or the apostles or the early apostolic fathers, for that matter, that not only was this taught by them, but also a salvation issue, then you win. Game over. You got me. Checkmate, right? But first time they fail, here's a second crack at it. Let's see if they did any better. I'm going to tell you they did not.
Question for Sam and William. No worries. If this assumption of Mary is essential for the faith, example salvation, why did it take the RCC to 1950 to make this a dogma to be saved?
Very, very quick answer. You don't want to take a whole lot of time up, because it is a very easy answer. The Pope was very clear that he wanted to give the world very, very beautiful hope by bringing forth something that was already believed from the beginning, already built into the liturgy. After World War II, after the world was wrecked by World War II, and you can read the very document, Munificentissimus Deus, where he tells you, look, he quotes early liturgies. He says, look, this has been believed from the beginning. Quoting.
Who taught the assumption of Mary was a salvific issue? Who? Who? I'd like to know, right? Was it taught by Jesus? Was it taught by the apostles, apostolic fathers? How far did it take? Now, they may have had the, you know, around the 350 AD and on, the doctrine, you know, of certain things of Mariology was starting to come forth, right? But it wasn't apostolic fathers who were teaching these doctrines. Don't be fooled by the charlatans out there teaching that, right? It was not taught early on, but it did evolve over time through traditions of the Catholic Church, right? And namely the Roman Catholic Church, when I talk about that, because early on, the first Christians were known as Catholics, but the Roman Catholic Church took over around the 4th and 5th century, and that's when things dramatically changed. So when we're talking about this here, when did this start happening? Yeah. But the problem is when this is being officially taught here, why did it take so long? Notice he does not answer the question.
Putting the liturgies and telling you the world is wrecked right now. People have going through tumultuous times. So he says this was divinely revealed. The church, and he notes how all of the apostolic churches believe this. So this.
Hear what he just said? All the apostolic fathers believe this. All the apostolic fathers believe this. No, they did not. And you know what? That is just wrong. It's just wrong. And to say otherwise is just, again, to try to defend their traditions. This is not at all what the Apostolic Fathers taught.
This was already built into the liturgy. It was elevated to the status of a dogma, but believed well before 1950, made a dogma then because of the particular events that were going on in the world.
So if I can just add one clarification.
Sure.
So basically, William, so people understand how dogma works.
Yeah.
Something that's dogmatized at one point doesn't mean it wasn't affirmed and necessary for belief prior.
Okay.
Just want to make sure, because they're thinking if it's not written in stone, then therefore that means people were free to reject it, even though it would have been part of the living teaching magisterium of the church.
Yeah, you have a problem then.
So prior to that, I'd be like to see how far back you can go. Which authorities were saying, how far back does it go, Sam or William? When did they make the assumption of Mary, this doctrine or teaching? When were they teaching this was a salvation issue? Before this was declared in 1950. If you say this was taught by the apostolic fathers, William, which is clearly false, completely just lying, then prove it. When did this start being taught by church leaders as a salvific issue? I'd like to know when specifically.
Did you reject it if it was taught as part of the church?
Right. It's a great point there, because then we would then say that, well, the Council of Nicaea dogmatized Christ being Lord. Was that not believed beforehand? Of course it was believed before. It's biblical. It was taught by the early church fathers.
So that he actually got right. It is biblical. The deity of Christ is biblical. The Trinity is biblical. It was taught by the apostolic fathers. In fact, I did a video not too long ago on my channel on the pre-Nicene church fathers, where I go through 15 different apostolic fathers before Nicaea, going through people of Methodius, Clement of Alexandria, going through Tertullian, going through Hippolytus, Cyprian of Carthage, Eusebius, Origen, going through Novatian, going through Irenaeus, going through Justin Martyr, Dionysius, Bishop of Alexandria, once again Hippolytus, Gregory, Thaumaturgus, Ignatius, Lactantius, and Matthias. All of these guys, when you look at it, these are pre-Nicene fathers and leaders who all affirmed, pointing to the deity of Christ and the doctrine of Trinity, and that Jesus was uncreated, eternal, begotten, but not created, but he always existed with the Father. So yeah. And then when the Nicene Council came together to come against modalism, the Sabellianists and Arianists, because they needed to come together to refute these false teachers, then that's when these creeds started coming into play, but they were already being taught. William or Sam, give me one apostolic father who taught the Assumption of Mary, and give us where this is essential for salvation. You cannot provide anything on that. So again, deflection.
Just because it was dogmatized in the 4th century, which is relatively late, doesn't mean that it wasn't believed and it wasn't built into the teaching of the faith before.
Problem again, Bible says, Jesus, unless you believe I am, you will die in your sins. John 8:24. Romans chapter 10, verses 9 through 13 states that you must believe Jesus has been raised from the dead from God, confessing with lips that he is Lord, and if you call upon the name of Yahweh, the Lord, meaning Jesus, you shall be saved. Acts 4:12, there is no other name under heaven by which we must be saved. The Bible affirms these doctrines. The apostolic first, what did they do? The apostolic fathers, what did they affirm what the scriptures taught? What did the early council do? They affirmed the scriptures. Assumption of Mary, these Marian doctrines, no, they are not biblical.
Okay, thank you, guys. Dan and Turton, did you have any thoughts on this specific question?
Sure. So the Council of Nicaea and basically the Trinity and Christology, it's superficial in Scripture that Christ is God and that sort of thing. So people had that, but reconciling divine simplicity with the Incarnation might have taken the Church some time to work out. But the Assumption of Mary isn't like that, because it's a historical event. It either happened or it didn't. It's kind of straightforward from that standpoint. But what I found interesting is the vastly different approach that we heard tonight from Sam and William than what I've heard from other Roman Catholic apologists. For example, Trent Horn just goes ahead and just says, we need to rely on papal authority for things like the Assumption of Mary.
That's Trent Horn. I mentioned earlier Robert Sedeus. You got also Trent Horn, Robert Sedeus, even Tim Staples, I said earlier. These are all people who are affirming, saying, look, this wasn't taught early on, but it's accepted by the magisterium. So the magisterium is the reason why they must believe in these doctrines. Not because the Bible teaches it, not because it's taught by the apostolic fathers, but because it's by the magisterium.
And then also, even more interesting, and to your point, Berean, perspective, is the debate, Robert Sedeus's approach. He straightforwardly bases the Assumption of Mary based on the Marian apparitions, especially the one that happened in France.
Yep.
So, that he gives a reason as to why it happened in 1950, but you know, it's interesting the wildly different approaches we see from Roman Catholic apologists.
Okay, thank you, Dan. Yes, Sam Willem, you guys get the last word.
Kurt, you want to say something before I
can? Let me briefly, very quickly say.
Let's see if maybe.
Oh, my bad. Turton, yeah, I'm sorry.
I have to say, almost the first time I think I've ever seen Sam actually be nice. He deserves a taco for that. He was actually being nice, letting Turton Van finish there. Even though 99.9% of the other times he's not, for once, Sam actually was nice. Way to go, Sam.
My friend?
Yeah. Let him in. I appreciate it. Very kind of you. I just wanted to clarify the exact wording that Pius XII used right after his definition, the very next number 44 is the definition. Number 45, he says, "Hence, if anyone, which God forbid, should dare willfully to deny or to call into doubt that which we have defined, let him know that he has fallen away completely from the divine and Catholic faith." And my contention is he has absolutely no scriptural warrant for saying that, and he has absolutely no traditional basis for thinking that this is a divinely revealed truth.
Now, what's interesting here, let me put this on the screen once again. He's quoting, again, the judgment here. And here it says here now, talks about the word willfully. I'm reading here 47. It says, "If any man forbidden, it is forbidden for any man to change our declaration, pronouncement, by definition, by rash attempt to oppose, counter it. If any man should presume to make such an attempt, let him know that he will incur the wrath of the Almighty." So I'm not sure he had the word willful, because this is where William is going to try and jump on him. But the fact is, he's still, it's still a declaration saying, look, if you come against us, you are going to receive the wrath of God. This is a salvation issue.
Notice the words willfully, and notice how today we very clearly laid out that biblical basis. So we ask people to just rewind and hear the debate over, and you will clearly note that very strong biblical basis that we laid forth. But I want to give.
So nothing was laid forth biblically sound. They relied mostly on Revelation 12 to try to prove that the woman was Mary. Not even if, I'll even use the word even if, it still doesn't address the question. The question is pertaining to Pope in 1950, right? It was declared by the Pope for judgment, right? Pope Pius XII, right? And when you're looking at this here, this is what's going on. This is a salvific issue, right? So this is important to understand. This is not taught anywhere in the Gospels. This is not taught anywhere in the New Testament. This is not taught by the Apostolic Fathers. So this is important to understand.
Give it, hand it over to Sam, and I'll piggyback if I need to.
Folks, I want you to hear what it said, because I think my...
Now listen to Sam's, again, deflection and assumptions and attacks. It's just ridiculous.
Brothers understand the implication of their own arguments, and I pray in Jesus' name that he illuminates all of us by his Spirit. Notice the Trinity, the deity of Christ, is clearly taught in scriptures that Jesus is God, not the Father, not the Spirit. And yet they just admit it took centuries for them to hammer out and articulate the precise exact relationships between Father, Son, and Spirit and the two natures. It didn't come overnight. Now, guys.
That's not true. They talked about divine simplicity here, talking about in regards to the two wills. I believe it was being referenced by Chap, I think it was, in relation to both his divine will and his human will. That was something that was being articulated later. But early on, like I demonstrated, guys, when I just went through a little while ago, I went through all these different early church fathers, apostolic fathers, sorry, pre-Nicaea. All of these guys pointing to the deity of Christ, pointing to the Trinity, pointing to Jesus being eternal, being uncreated. All of these different references here. This was not something that was confusing or, for that matter, not understandable. Also, when you're looking at the Bible, you can see the doctrine of the incarnation in John chapter 1 and Philippians chapter 2, where these are biblical teachings. This wasn't something that had to be necessarily completely understood so long later. This was in the Bible. The assumption of Mary is not in the Bible. Huge difference. Apples and oranges here, folks. Apples and oranges, right? So Sam, once again, is deflecting, going off target, missing the mark by thousands and thousands of miles, folks. And listen to how he says this here. Watch this. Listen.
Put on your thinking back. If something that's so well attested, as such as the two natures of Christ and the Trinity, so well attested, still took time for Christians to argue and fight, even come to blows, to get down the position of the language, such, so they're doing, you know, understanding, why are they shocked that the assumption of Mary may have taken some later time to be defined, understood, and developed, especially when I just said that the book of Revelation, which came the basis for that doctrine, was called in dispute for centuries before it's canonized. So thank you for making our case, because something that is not as...
So as I mentioned earlier, the book of Revelation was referenced many, many times early on by the church fathers, over 36,000 references from the New Testament, other than roughly, they say, 5 to 10 verses potentially that weren't contained in all the church fathers' quotes. So that just refutes of itself Sam Shamoun, because they were referencing early on as this being scripture. What was recognized officially did come a little bit around the 3rd century, true. But as I mentioned earlier, majority of the New Testament was recognized early on, and by the church fathers essentially quoting from all the New Testament, except for a handful of verses. So again, Sam, you fall short. It went down like a sack of potatoes. All that you did here was deflect and not actually give a good response.
It's well attested in scripture. We would expect it would take longer for someone to then come to the right conclusion guided by the Spirit. But something so well attested scripture, you just admit that it was centuries before they came up with monothelitism or diatheletism and diaphysitism.
No, we didn't.
But does that mean that prior to those formulations, someone could deny that Jesus is eternally God and not become a heretic because it wasn't codified? Be consistent, my brothers.
All right. Sam earns the award for this one here.
What you just said is one of the most insanely idiotic things I have ever heard. At no point in your rambling, incoherent response were you even close to anything that could be considered a rational thought. Everyone in this room is now dumber for having listened to it.
All right, so you've heard it, guys. This is what's been going on in their debate review. Now what I'm going to play here for you is a couple quick things here from my debate with Sam. I'm going to put this on the screen for you guys to see. And this really gets to the heart of the debate with all that's been going on here. I'm going to first play a little thing with Sam when I was on his channel, because this is what I want to encourage all of you guys out there. Don't assume what Sam states is true. Be a Berean. He throws out a lot of information. He quotes different things as if it's always supposed to be right. And he always tries to get people on his channel to give him the references, this and that. And in my debate with him, I challenged him, and I wanted him to go to the scripture, him to read from the Bible, right? And he didn't like that. Watch how this went. This is a short clip, but it's still memorable and funny. Is that what you said?
Yes, read it for me.
So go ahead. Go ahead.
Do you have it up? You want me to read
it
or you want
I'd like you to read it. Go for it.
Okay, so then why did you bring it up when I said bring it up? So let me read it now. All right.
Well, if you're going to, I mean, if I ask someone.
But you've been following me, right? And you know that my patterns have people to read, but that's okay. I'll break the pattern for you.
It's good for you to open your Bible once in a while too, Sam.
So watch that cheap shot ad hominem, the guy who's playing nice.
It's just a common sense statement.
It's okay. It's okay. You take cheap shots, and I'm going to go for your juggler sooner than later. Keep it up.
Okay, buddy.
All right, first.
So the funny thing was, is in that debate, he desperately tried to bully me, control me, but I kept pressing him back on what's his Bible authority. He couldn't give me true authority. He tried to point to traditions of the church from 1 Timothy 3:15. I refuted that. He tried to then take me down this rabbit trail about early church with the water baptism, all that. I refuted that. Then we got to the issue of, you know, he tried to prove that men could actually be worshipped in the Bible. So he's actually now completely agreeing with worshiping men, and i.e. then, of course, that would then mean worshiping Mary, which he doesn't realize that totally backfired on him there. And then the issue of praying to Mary. There's nothing in the Bible about anything at all about Mary being a mediator, or for that matter, her being an intercessor and praying to her, and yet he failed on all of that. So again, I want to encourage you guys, no matter who you're listening to, myself or anyone else, always, always, always go to the scriptures. Now, I want to point this one on the screen here, and this is important. This is going to be a big one here, and this is the reason why I'm pointing this out to you guys. This is going to be probably about how far does it go here? It's going to be about a 16 minutes I'm going to play for you guys of my discussion when I was on William's channel about a month ago on the debate on the perpetual virginity of Mary. Different topic, but still relevant to this on the issue of Marian doctrines. Are Marian doctrines essential for salvation? Now, the issue of Theotokos, I get that. The issue of Mary being the God-bearer. Yes, she brought forth Isaiah 7:14, Matthew 1:23. We know that Jesus was God come in the flesh. I don't deny that. The issue of contention here is the issue of Immaculate Conception, the issue of veneration of Mary, the issue of her being a mediatrix, the issue of perpetual virginity, the issue of the body of summit. These dogmas, as we've already been pointed out, William has openly agreed. You'll listen in a minute. He agrees the dogmas, the Marian doctrines, are essential for salvation. Now, he tries to focus more on the Theotokos, which I have more agreement than disagreement. But the issue of Theotokos within the Catholic Church is, the problem is then they want to talk about her being the God-bearer, but then they want to also elevate her as Queen of Heaven. They want to venerate her, and to those things, that's where that becomes idolatrous. Can she be called the Theotokos in a sense? Sure. Bible even talks about her being called the Mother of our Lord, but not in the same way that the Catholic Church does it, the Roman Catholic Church, because they venerate her and put her to a place of idolatry, right? So you're going to listen to this debate that I was on his channel. I want you guys to see it. I'm going to let you listen to it, and then you guys see this is an actual debate, me pressing the great debater, William Albrecht, on the issue of the perpetual virginity of Mary, but the issue also of, is this essential for salvation? And my three questions were, did Jesus teach it? Where did he teach it? Where did the apostles teach it? And where did the apostolic churches teach that this is essential for salvation? So you get to check this out. Let's see if William, in an actual live debate with me, did any, if he could refute me, bust me, expose me, do all that so many people are claiming. Did he actually prove it from Jesus' teachings? Did he prove it from the apostles? And did he prove it from the apostolic early church that this is essential for salvation, i.e. a dogma of the Catholic Church? So here we go. Ready for it, guys? Enjoy this discussion. As a Roman Catholic, because this is different, I know, within the Orthodox Church and things like that, so there are similarities, of course. So me asking you, William Albrecht, is it Albrecht pronounced properly?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, I always want to make sure I get that right. You as a Roman Catholic, how essential for you is these doctrines known as the Marian doctrines? In other words, how relevant and important to you are these of the faith?
They are the heart of Christology. They were the heart of Christology in the early church. They're the heart of Christology in the Bible. They are essential to our faith. The Marian dogmas are essential to our faith, and the most vital one, important one, is Holy Mary as our Theotokos, because it points
to
Christ.
Say
every dogma vital. Points to Christ.
So when you say vital, could a person like myself, Kelly Powers, as a Protestant, non-denominational believer in Jesus Christ, if I don't believe in the Marian doctrines per se, what would be, in your opinion, as a Roman Catholic, dogma? If I die in the state I'm in right now and I don't come to the same view as you, is this a salvation issue?
Kelly, it is a massive salvation issue if you deny our Holy Mother Mary as Theotokos, because it is a
Christological... I didn't bring up Theotokos. I'm just talking about it in general.
That's a dogma.
I know.
You're going to have to let me answer you. So you're going to have to let me... Well, you're interrupting me. You're going to have to let me answer you. Denying Holy Mary as Theotokos, as Mother of God, is a denial of the incarnation and a denial of one of the most important, if not the most important aspect of Christology. So yeah, I'd say you wouldn't be a Christian if you denied that particular dogma. Okay. You wouldn't be a Christian. So I would be worried about your soul.
Okay. Fair enough.
And I have to be fair. Every person that I dialogue with on the Marian dogmas, I try to educate them and say these dogmas point to Christ.
Right on. So Marian doctrines, stupid fly in my face here. Marian doctrines, according to you, are vital and essential and salvific to the point of someone like myself, if I didn't hold to the Marian doctrines, I wouldn't be saved, right?
They're Christological. It's denying the incarnation. Hold on. I'm going to answer that, Kelly. You're going to have to let me answer.
I haven't got to my question yet, man. Come on.
Well, you said the word, and I want to emphasize.
I was just reiterating what you said, so I can get to my question. You're not letting me ask my question now.
I would expect to hear a denial of the incarnation from a person like Greg Stafford, not from you, Kelly.
That's right. So in the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, is it true, yes or no, that Jesus claimed he is the I am he, and that if you don't believe in him, you will die in your sins?
No doubt.
John 14:16, Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. Is it only through Jesus
that
we get to the Father?
Preach it, brother. Preach it.
That's right.
Amen. I'll say amen to all of you.
Brother. Amen. Right on.
Go, brother.
There's no other name in heaven by which we must be saved. Acts 4:12, correct?
No, keep preaching, brother.
Help me out here, brother. Where did Jesus teach it was essential to believe in these Marian doctrines that you just said a moment ago are essential to the Christian faith? Where did he teach them?
Matthew 1, behold a virgin.
Matthew taught that? I'm asking Jesus.
Are you going to allow me to answer?
Jesus is not Matthew chapter 1.
I'm going to tell you right now. You're going to have to allow me to answer your question.
I'm asking you a question about Jesus.
And I am telling you, everything you just quoted from Christ points to Christ as eternal God. And it is essential to believe in Mary as Mother of God because it points to that truth. A denial of Mary as Theotokos is a denial of everything you just read.
Her being the Mother of God is salvation.
Now, that's a fallacious question because
I'm asking you a very clear question.
Here's another. So we take the whole of the Bible as the Word of God. We don't say, No, I believe that the Word of God is inspired, the inspired Word of God. And if the Word of God is inspired, then that's the message of Christ, Kelly. I don't need to have him uttering those words.
I could go down the line and ask you a question just a minute ago about specific things about Jesus, the gospel, the faith. And you said, yes, brother, preach it. Amen.
Kelly,
I ask you a question. Where did Jesus teach it? And you can't.
It's biblical. It's in the Gospel of St. Luke that she's a perpetually vowed virgin. It's biblical.
Not Jesus teaching. I'm asking a specific question about Jesus.
Oh, wow. So if Christ doesn't utter those words, his inerrant word is not true, Kelly. This is outrageous, Kelly.
When did Jesus start teaching?
Kelly, I don't know your point. Your point is,
Jesus specifically start teaching? You don't know? You're supposed to be the scholar.
Oh,
I'm the dummy here.
I do know. I do know. When he was an older adult, he began to teach. But you're trying to pin the question.
Hold on, Kelly. Where did Jesus teach? I'm asking you, Kelly, my question.
I'm perplexed, William. And I've
where did Jesus teach this kind of this essential faith?
I'm going to answer you. And I'm sorry, you're going to allow me to answer you.
I'll allow you, trying to keep you in the question.
Your argument is a fallacious one that I hear Jehovah's Witnesses use all the time. Just because it's not uttered from the words of Christ, well, the canon of Scripture doesn't come off the lips of Christ either. But we take the whole of Scripture as the inerrant Word of God. And when we take the whole of Scripture as the inerrant Word of God that comes from Christ, the Logos, we find that Mary is a perpetually vowed virgin in Luke 1. I'm not done. And we find that Mary is Mother of God in Matthew chapter 1. Kelly, you asked me, where does Christ teach this? You quote him as eternal God over and over, and you say, well, where does he teach
this? I'm going to move on to another question.
Mary has the
focus. You didn't answer. That's fine.
Oh, I answered you clearly.
You didn't answer from Jesus. You answered from other places.
Oh, well, I guess Luke is not infallible.
Not a single place.
I guess Luke is not the Word of God, right?
Jesus is not speaking in Matthew chapter 1.
My next question is from the apostles. I'm going to answer you.
Okay.
I don't think that every single word that Christ uttered
has then been put into dogma because he didn't utter the canon of scripture, even though that was passed down through sacred
tradition.
We're
talking about eternal salvation, salvific, use of the logo. This is essential vital teaching. So why is this such an important teaching when yet it's not taught by Jesus?
It's biblical. That's why.
And yes, biblical, but where did Jesus teach it?
Kelly. Anything okay. that is taught
let's
biblically,
move on. I'm trying to be nice. Anything, to move on. I'm trying
anything
to be nice.
That
move
is
on.
Biblical, if it's biblical, it's the word of God. It's
that's,
confirmed
that's fine.
By
so,
eternal
so nowhere Jesus taught. It's fine. So
I'm blown away question, that you're putting
my,
the Bible.
My next question, if I can get there.
I'm blown
my
away.
Next question is from Peter or the apostles. Same question. Where do we see this essential, vital, Saint faith, Luke. Salvific doctrine yes. from the apostles' teachings? Now, this is their teachings. Yeah. Where did they teach from Acts or their epistles in their teachings after now Jesus being resurrected? And he says, go therefore and teach them all that I've commanded you. Where did the apostles teach
them? Kelly, I know you love trying to say, well, in this book or in that book, but I got to be fair with you, Kelly. I don't need to find a particular teaching in the book of your liking. I've already quoted the gospel.
Give me the whole New Testament. It's pretty easy.
I told you, Luke. About 20 times already.
So, in but Saint where Luke, did the apostles Mary, teach it?
Goodness, it was preached all throughout
Luke is
history,
not an apostle, number one.
Luke is an evangelist.
Luke is a Greek Gentile who is a convert later under the apostle Paul.
Oh, goodness. So Luke's words
but
are
again,
against the apostles.
The point is I'm asking a question. I'll be
I'm
more specific.
By this.
I'll be more specific.
I'm shocked.
From Acts 1, we hear about Mary. From Acts 2 and on, we don't hear anything about the teaching pertaining to Mary, of anything about Marian doctrines in the epistles of the apostles. I'm asking you, where do they, any of these guys teach that this is such a vital, essential, salvific doctrine?
So I'm going to answer you, and you're not going to interrupt me. I'm telling you right now.
I'll give you free liberty.
I've already told you that I can point to areas where they actually talk about this theology. Not every single book of the Bible addresses Mary. That's a ridiculous fallacy, claiming, well, we don't have her in Peter. Well, we don't have her in this book. What does that matter? There's a lot of things in St. Paul that we don't have. We don't have a lot of things enunciated there. We take the whole of Scripture, and we take the whole of sacred tradition, Kelly. And when we take St. Luke's gospel, by the way, saying that Luke is not an apostle, so he's a lesser person. No, we believe the whole Bible is the inspired word of God, Kelly. In Luke, she is taught to be a perpetually vowed virgin. And then we read of her more in the book of Revelation, chapter 11 and chapter 12. We got enough of her in Luke 1 when she's presented as a new ark of the new covenant, Kelly. We got enough of Mary there. We have enough of her in Matthew as well, where she's presented as the mother of God, the God-bearer. So the fallacy of, well, we need to have her in these books, I don't fall for that trap, Kelly. I believe the whole word of God is inspired.
Can I respond now? So what I'm asking
is your cross-examination.
Well, that's wonderful. I appreciate that. So I'm asking questions first off from Jesus and the apostles, because this is where we first get our major teachings from the early church, from those guys. So what I haven't heard so far is from Jesus or from the apostles' teachings now post-resurrection. Mm. I am not hearing anything from them as these Marian doctrines,
here's another interesting
as
thing.
Salvific and vital, according to your words.
So here's another interesting thing. Salvific and vital, and I've quoted Matthew 1 about 20 times already.
You can quote 20 more, it doesn't answer it.
That says, presenting Mary as the God-bearer. That's the dogma of her being Theotokos. That
that's
is essential to our salvation.
No, that I'm asking
points,
you.
Kelly, it points to our Lord as in the incarnate God. How is that not essential to salvation to believe that Christ is God? I am
I'm going to go on your strength here.
I'm
going to go now to church fathers.
Yeah,
I can't answer from the New
let
Testament.
Me be very, I've answered
there.
Over and over.
There's nothing
I've answered
there.
You.
There's nothing
I've answered
there.
You.
And now in the
done,
first
I hope your audience
few,
recognizes
you,
one
you
thing.
You haven't answered squat, okay?
I hope
the
your
first
audience
few
recognizes
centuries,
I can answer you. I'm going to answer your comment.
You got something new that you haven't answered yet?
I'm going to answer your comment, your insult that I don't have squat. Kelly, I've answered everything.
Because you keep
you don't
coming back
Mary
and saying you keep answering it as
answer
if I
you.
Don't know what I'm talking about,
Kelly,
which I have from the New Testament.
This is cross-examination, not time to pontificate. So I'm going to answer that
statement.
You've
been talking more than me.
I'm going to answer that statement that you just made. It is vitally important to believe that Christ is eternal God, bound up with Mary.
I agree with that. Jesus teaches that. Amen. Bound up. That. Yes.
I've been trying to tell you that over and over. Bound up with all the statements of Christ, they're all true, just like Matthew 1, where it teaches that Mary is the God-bearer, is true. We don't need to have Christ saying, hey, she's the God-bearer. It's confirmed in the infallible word, Kelly.
I don't believe this garbage of putting Bible in the New Testament. Everything that's essential for faith hinges on believing in Jesus, trusting in Jesus.
That's what
following Jesus, believing who he is. There is zero when it comes to Mary.
And I'm going to answer that because this isn't time to pontificate. I just pointed
you give me something that can refute it, then you win.
Kelly, I've answered you over and over.
You have
I've dealt with a major dogmatic teaching. Mary as mother of God, what does it point to? It points
that
to
is
Christ.
Not the question I'm asking you.
No, yeah, you did. Not, you asked
you're
me.
Answering it with a different question. That's Kelly, not the question I'm asking.
You asked me to point to you how these are essential for salvation. Right. Mary,
I'm going to let you finish and then go to the next question. Okay?
Yes. Mary as mother of God is the primary dogma, the main dogma of which all the others flow, Kelly. And that dogma points to Christology. So you better believe it's essential for salvation to believe that Jesus is the God-man. That is essential for salvation, my friend.
Okay. Can I move on my question?
Over and over. Move on.
Can I move on? Wonderful. In the early church, now I'm talking like pre-Nicaea, before 325, I'm talking like the early church, people like Polycarp, people like Justin Martyr, people like Ignatius, these kind of people. In the first few centuries, I'm talking like pre-Nicaea, be very clear in my words here.
Yeah.
Where do we see this teaching of Mary with such prominence and especially on the issue of salvation, this matters?
Yeah. So you find this teaching to be essential in the Proto-Evangelium of James, which is written in the 100s. You find it in St. Clement of Alexandria in his Stromata. You find it in St. Gregory the Wonder Worker as well. Those are three very early writers. Polycarp of Smyrna's letter to the Philippians is the only letter we have of his. He doesn't mention a lot of things there, just like St. Ignatius. But silence doesn't refute this dogma. So I just listed
I don't think you understand my question.
I listed three anti-Nicene sources.
But do any of them actually specifically say you have to believe in these Marian doctrines for like salvation issue? That's what I'm asking you.
It doesn't matter if they say that it's salvation.
Where do we get any of them stating this is a salvific salvation issue?
Oh, Kelly, goodness, you got me in the corner. They teach it and they believe it, but they didn't say, hey, you won't be saved if you don't believe it. Yeah, you really got me there.
I started off with something real simple for you, William.
Yeah.
I said, Jesus said, unless you believe I am, you will die in your sins. You said, yes. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but me. You said, preach it, brother. I can go through the whole New Testament, reference after reference after reference about the importance of believing in Jesus. And if you don't, you will die in your sins and go to hell. This we agree. We have zero when it comes to Mary.
Kelly, I just gave you three anti-Nicene.
You did not give me anything yet.
You asked me, Kelly, for three early sources that taught the perpetual virginity of Mary. And then you said, oh, well, where do they say it's a salvation issue? They don't need to say it's a salvation issue, Kelly.
Let's just move on.
I'm not done answering, though.
Unless you can give me a specific reference, then all you're doing is wasting time.
Really? Clement of Alexandria, Stromata, Proto-Evangelium.
Where is he saying this is a salvation issue that you must believe in Mary?
Yeah, I'm going to finish. Every early church father, when talking about Mary as mother of God or the perpetual virginity of Mary, were very clear. The church believed it in unanimity.
Polycarp, Justin Martyr,
believed it.
These guys, they teach it?
Kelly, I'm telling
you. Where they teach it at? That's a fallacious statement.
Kelly, I'm telling you the early fathers that taught it. Justin Martyr
doesn't
talk about
400 later. That's not the early church.
Really? 100 is 300.
You give me a reference from these early guys that this was a salvific issue preparing to Mary.
I'm going to answer you. I've already won.
Game over. I will become a Catholic.
Kelly, you're not going to become a Catholic, Kelly, because what you are going to do, I've just shown you they believed in the perpetual virginity of Mary. And now you say, what do they say salvation is about?
Come on, Kelly. All right. So that is where I started going into the issue in the debate about Matthew 13 and other places, demonstrating and proving that, yes, Mary did actually, in fact, have biological choice. That's where I kind of went from there. I went to Mark 6 and other places like that. And eventually, you know, got, that was my cross-examination. Then we did our closing comments here and there. But here's the point of what I was bringing this up for you guys to get. I asked three things, specifically Jesus. Where did Jesus teach this? A salvific. Where did the apostles teach it? A salvific. And where did the early apostolic fathers? Now, he brought up in this discussion Clement of Alexandria. He's the only one, really, early on, that has any kind of reference to something about the perpetual virginity of Mary. Okay. In that, he's actually quoting the Proto-Evangelium. The Proto-Evangelium has been proven to be a fraudulent document. It's got many contradictions that go all over the Bible, contrary against the Bible, many things that are inaccurate. And even up until the 4th and 5th century, the Catholic Pope, Innocent, condemned it. And Galileus, I think his name was pronounced, in the 5th century, both condemned it early on by popes. And this is even attested even in Catholic.com and other sources. But it became accepted later on, the Proto-Evangelium being accepted. In this debate, I even asked William, I said, how much stock do you put on the Proto-Evangelium? He's like, well, it's good historical. But he always uses it in reference to prove Mariology. So it is a source of authority for it, but it's actually a fraudulent, fake and false document that he uses. And this is where, sadly, Clement of Alexandria, he references, but he's only talking about what it states. He actually wasn't affirming directly the perpetual virginity of Mary. So here's the point. Even early on, the apostolic fathers did not teach first the Immaculate Conception. Won't find that there. Won't find the perpetual virginity of Mary. Won't find the bodily assumption of Mary. And you won't find the issue of veneration of Mary. Those things are definitely not there. And then the defense of the Theotokos, this came later on when the issues of Nestorius and things like that. But I get that. And I actually don't, I probably have more agreement with Theotokos than not, even as a Protestant, because it is talking about the incarnation of Christ. The difference I would have is that the emphasis that's been over the years, the emphasis of venerated Mary as Queen of Heaven and things like that, that it has happened over the years with calling Mary the Theotokos, right? So here's where we end off in this discussion, my friends. In this debate with William and Sam debating Dan Chapa and Turretin-Van, I believe Turretin-Van and Dan Chapa did a decent job, did a good job in that debate. Highly recommend you guys go watching on Center for Truth channel. They did a good job. There's some things I probably wouldn't agree with completely, but those are minor issues. The point is, in that debate, Revelation 12 teaches literally nothing about the Virgin Mary there. It's so obvious. It's talking about Israel being the woman. It's abundantly clear there. The child of Jesus points to the Messiah. I agree with that, but I'm not getting that right now. The issue that I brought this up today is because in this debate, it was brought up by Dan Chapa and others and Turton about the issue of this being a salvific. They talked about it earlier on in the presentation. So I thought, you know what? I'm glad I asked my questions as well. And now I did a video to demonstrate that both Sam and William failed. Not only did Sam fail in debates against me with two of them, he failed both of those. If he ever does a third, it'll be three strikes for him. I had a debate with William, even though he can bark and shout and do whatever he wants. He did not prove from the Bible the perpetual virginity of Mary, and he failed horribly, even worse, more so, on the issue of it being a salvific issue of the perpetual virginity and the Marian doctrines in general that I was asking. And in this debate, I brought it up for two reasons, because I want to talk about Jesus, the apostles, and the early apostolic fathers' silence on these issues, the Marian doctrines, and particularly dead silence on the issue of the Assumption of Mary. Even Catholic scholars even agree with that, said it came much later. And the crazy thing is now that it's been made a dogma as essential for salvation in the Catholic Church, and yet the problem is the Bible clearly does not teach this as a salvific issue. If you were to reject Mary as a Theotokos, this would get into the incarnation. There is some agreement there for sure. I would get to that. But what the Theotokos in the Catholic Church has become much more broad in that term, right? So rejecting Jesus Christ being God come in the flesh, yes, that would be a salvific issue. But rejecting Mary as the Immaculate Conception, rejecting Mary as a mediatrix or venerated Mary, nope. Assumption of Mary and the issue of the bodily assumption, perpetual virginity, all those different other things that the other Marian doctrines, right? None of those, literally none of those have to do with anything to do with salvation. Have there been people in the past, even Reformed people, Protestants who have had some of these agreements, the issue of Assumption of Mary, the issue of perpetual virginity of Mary? Yeah. But these are not salvation issues. What is the gospel? What is the gospel for salvation? The gospel is simply this, John 3:16, right? Ephesians 2:8 and 9, Romans 10:9-13, Acts 4:12, John 8:24. The list goes on that you must believe that Jesus is the Christ, God come in flesh, sent from the Father, anointed the Holy Spirit. These are the things the Bible clearly teaches and lays it out. And even early on, the church fathers, the apostolic church fathers, taught on these matters. Why? Because they were biblical. Marian doctrines, unbiblical. Amen, amen. Hey, thank you for watching this video. I hope that you were blessed by it and encouraged. Check out my debate. The link will be in the description, of course, with my debate with William. Check out the full debate. I encourage it. Check it out. Watch my debate with Sam as well, as I went onto his channel a little while back doing the Jerry Springer show. Check those things. I am open, transparent. I'm growing. I'm learning. There's sometimes things that I don't always get either. But look, one thing I do get is the Bible is clear that Jesus is the one that we serve and follow. He's the one that we worship and are to learn from the New Testament scriptures. He's the one that came to reveal and exegete God the Father to the world. John 1:18. He came to reveal who the Father was. The Holy Spirit, he, a distinct person, the Father and Son, he's the one who testifies to both the Father and of Jesus Christ. We read about this in Scripture. These are core doctrines of the Christian faith. Mariology, that's idolatry. And I'll leave it at that. Thank you for watching. Please like this video. Please leave a comment. Please support this ministry in any way if you can through PayPal. Lord bless you. May you grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord bless you.
In case I don't see you, good afternoon, good evening, good night.
Life moves pretty fast. You don't stop and look around once in a while, you could miss it.
I'll be back.